September is upon us, and this last month was very productive for science. So here are 10 amazing scientific discoveries for September 2024. Number 10. Synthetic butter. As Julia Child once said, butter makes anything taste good. Whether you agree with that or not, I have to admit that popcorn with real butter is a guilty pleasure for JMG movie nights. But with butter comes the cow, and with the cow comes the pasture, and transporting the butter and the cow, and so on and so forth, making for a rather resource-intensive product. But researchers have been asking a question: could synthetic butter be easier to make than the real thing? Granted, this is an old question. There have been butter substitutes around for a very long time. Margarine was invented in 1869, and according to James Burke, had connections with early research into napalm. That said, the new research is part of a series of projects to develop synthetic foods, and in this case, derives its materials from carbon dioxide or methane and carbon. Through the process, you end up with triglycerides, and then you have your fats, which you can then process into butter using beta-carotene as natural coloring and natural flavors like rosemary oil to achieve something like butter. You could even play with ideas of better than butter with the right flavorings, or entirely new butter-like products in the same way that one can find flavored cream cheeses. The use of this, however, is in resources because it's still calories, could be delicious, and requires much less to produce than real butter, meaning this will find uses in disaster and famine relief, lower the dependency on butter substitutes, which are usually based on palm or coconut oils, and aren't that environmentally friendly because of deforestation, and so on. I think the real challenge will be acceptance of synthetic fats, especially after the debacle involving trans fats, which in addition to ruining many fast food French fries before they switch to healthier alternatives, after thinking they had switched to a healthier alternative than beef tallow and such, was found to be extremely unhealthy, causing a move away from it. Yes, decent French fries are also a guilty pleasure. Number 9. Jupiter's red spot may not be that old. One interesting thing in astronomy has been the question of Jupiter's iconic red spot, a giant storm that seemed stable, but at times has changed colors, contracted, and showed signs of maybe shutting down. But throughout it, it was commonly believed that this storm had been raging for centuries or more, but that may not be the case. The red spot, or so it was thought, was first sighted by Giovanni Domenico Cassini in 1665, but it may not be the red spot as we know it that he actually saw. New modeling seems to suggest that it wasn't, and that it was an earlier storm that has since dissipated. One of the reasons for this is that Cassini's spot was last recorded a full 118 years before reliable observations of the current red spot came in. There seems to have been nothing going on at Jupiter during that period. The modeling suggests that the current spot is the result of changes in Jupiter's wind patterns combined with a weather disturbance, basically gas from one of the bands getting disturbed, causing it to form up, and those conditions persist, but evolve, accounting for the observed changes in the spot over the years. How much longer the Great Red Spot will last is anyone's guess. Number 8. A new understanding of chirality. One of the huge questions lurking in astrobiology is the question of chirality, or handedness. Molecules can organize either way, left or right-handed. But life on Earth does this in a specific way. Deoxyribose and ribose sugars in DNA and RNA are always right-handed across all life on Earth, and the amino acids are left-handed. It was thought that this must be due to chance or some unknown physical effect, because their counterparts should in principle have worked just as well. But that may not actually be the case, due to what apparently was a happy accident in a lab. And it seems due to cell membranes, made of fatty molecules, which are also chiral, though this varies a bit among the archaea and bacteria. The researchers found that certain configurations of those fatty molecules actually resulted in the membranes being more permeable to the exact chiralities that Earth life uses, giving a physical reason why it happens that way. In other words, the wrong chirality essentially gets filtered out, and that may go all the way back to prebiotic chemistry, At the same time, however, this doesn't completely close the gap. It just offers one possible explanation for why Earth life uses the chiralities that it does, an insight. But there may be alternatives that Earth life did not come to use. Number 7. The Komodo Dragon's Iron Teeth. Few living reptiles are as impressive as the Komodo dragon. Native to a few islands in Indonesia, they are the largest living lizard, growing up to 3 meters in length. This makes them true apex predators in their environment, though they do also forage for carrion, and occasionally even go after humans. As impressive as they are, there are still new facts surfacing about these amazing lizards. A new one is the fact that its razor-sharp teeth incorporate iron. Researchers studying Komodo dragon teeth actually were paleontologists studying dinosaurs. They wanted to know why carnivorous dinosaur teeth were so good at cutting, which led them to the Komodo dragons, which are not dinosaurs by any means, but they do bear some relation. They found that the Komodo dragon teeth have orange stains on their serrations, and chemical analysis showed that this was actually a coating of iron on the surface of the tooth, something that was also found with other monitor lizards, and even the crocodiles and alligators, suggesting that the dinosaurs likely had this as well. The problem is that proving the dinosaurs had the iron coating is nearly impossible, because traces of iron are just not distinguishable from normal environmental iron oxide in the fossil record. Indeed, just by being a fossil introduces iron seeping into the stone as the original bone is replaced. So there's just no way to distinguish where the iron is originally from. And the modern reptile teeth also show that iron coating is very thin to begin with. But it may be the closest we can come to understanding just why dinosaur teeth were so efficiently deadly. Number 6. The Moon Spider Caves. No, the moon does not have spiders, just something that sort of looks like one, that seems to indicate something even more interesting. So the moon spiders are geologic features that look something like sinkholes here on Earth appear. The legs of the spiders are gullies that formed as the lunar soil drained down into a hole. The features are located in formerly volcanic areas on the moon, including the Sea of Tranquility, and may indicate voids that formed as magma outgassed subsurface. Eventually, the ceilings of these voids collapsed, forming the spiders, probably due to seismic activity. These voids may actually be connected underground, forming a cave system of sorts, and it's also thought that there probably used to be many more of these spider features on the moon that have been erased by the micrometeoroid gardening that the surface of the moon is subject to. And here is the problem. That means that there are voids like this that we don't know about, potentially quite a lot of them. And if we're going to put a human base on the surface of the moon, along with engaging in further manned exploration, then we need to stay away from these areas, lest one of these things collapse from underneath a lunar exploration vehicle. And it's also worth remembering that the Sea of Tranquility is where Apollo 11 landed. That may have been far more dangerous than we knew in 1969. Number 5. You can't make a black hole from pure light. When we think of black holes, we tend to see them as matter collapsing in on itself, but that's not actually the only way to make a black hole. Within general relativity, there is a possibility, at least on its face, of creating a black hole entirely from concentrated energy. Mass and energy are equivalent. This type of black hole is termed a Kugelblitz black hole, and they have long been wondered about in physics and futurism, but they seem to have hit a snag. Researchers at the University of Waterloo in Canada recently did calculations on whether the idea of a Kugelblitz was actually viable, or simply sat in the not prohibited by general relativity basket, but not possible in practice, and it turns out that the amount of light needed isn't possible in the universe. Even an active galactic nucleus doesn't produce enough, and to do it artificially, as has sometimes been suggested, does not appear to be possible, and requires 10 to the 50th more energy than our most powerful lasers currently produce. This is mainly for a small Kugelblitz, but all of them are unlikely, except for one thing. While you can't create one now, the early universe just after the Big Bang was very different, and under those circumstances, it remains possible that primordial Kugelblitzes might have been created. Whatever happened to them, if any ever existed, is unknown. Number 4. Bizarre early cells. One of the biggest challenges facing research into abiogenesis and the earliest stages of life on Earth is a lack of fossils. Earth destroys its rocks, and very few places on planet Earth still boast rocks from the first billion years of the planet's existence, which also contains the time period when life on Earth arose. But there are some interesting candidate fossils that may show some kind of early life. 3.8 billion year old sedimentary rocks, actually from multiple locations across the world, have been found that appear to contain microfossils of what appear to be cells. Early life, like what this might be, has always been assumed to have been primitive. But these new fossils are strange in that they show no cell wall, but they do have internal structures, and they are awfully large for a microorganism. So they actually appear to be too complex in one way, too large, but also primitive in another way. That called the findings of these fossils, which date back to 1987, into question. New work at the Max Planck Institute, however, may have shed light on this. They focused on a type of microorganism living in the Dead Sea that had bizarre shapes, no cell wall, and were termed L-forms when they were first discovered in the 1930s. It turns out that these microorganisms, when put in a high salinity environment, acquire the structure of these fossils, they look like them, and actually lack a definitive shape, unlike a bacteria with a cell wall. They also produced carbon structures, basically it leaks out of them, which is also present in the microfossils, providing potentially a new insight in early life's diversity on Earth. Number 3. Virtual life forms. This is a strange one. Researchers at Google created a kind of analog of life in digital form, something like the organizing molecules involved in the very first stages of the abiogenesis of life. They took snippets of computer code, tens of thousands of them, and set them to where they could randomly mingle with other bits of code over millions of generations, in a situation where there was no rules or rewards should anything come out of it. The expectation was that it would remain random and nothing coherent would come out. That's not what happened, however. Instead, they got self-replicating programs, eventually emerging and replicating so much that it hit the population cap of the experiment. As it developed, new types of replicators started appearing and competing with the others, just like natural selection. It pays to remember here, these are computer programs, not life. But life also is a kind of information storage medium that has genetic data to create an organism. So while not the same, it is somewhat similar, and the experiment speaks to the ability for complexity to arise from randomness, something that seems to have happened with genetics and abiogenesis. This experiment is nearing the limits of what we can do with computers, but it's thought that even more evolution and complexity is possible with this. But ultimately, it's just about self-replicating computer code emerging. It's not life, and it's not something that will answer the abiogenesis question. Rather, it provides an interesting framework in how complexity can arise where it isn't necessarily expected. This seems to happen a lot with computers these days, unforeseen effects, and only time will tell what that means for things like artificial intelligence. Number 2. The Thick Atmosphere Exoplanet. In the first 2 years of operations, the James Webb Space Telescope has yielded a treasure trove of discoveries. It's unbelievable how successful that telescope has been, exceeding all expectations. But the one thing it kept coming up dry on was the question of rocky exoplanets with atmospheres. This was strange, because look at the solar system. Titan, Venus, Earth, Mars all have substantial atmospheres. But when they began characterizing the TRAPPIST-1 system and others, so far, everything appeared to have no substantial atmosphere, until now. The planet in question, 55 Cancri E, is a super-Earth that is very, very close to its parent star, which is 55 Cancri A, a type K orange dwarf that actually is a binary star with a red dwarf also in the system. Incidentally, this discovery shows that type K stars can have planets with atmospheres, very important in astrobiology in general. The planet is extremely hot as a result of proximity to its star, so not on the table for life, Its year is 17 hours long, one of the shortest of the known exoplanets, and its surface is molten as a result. And it should have no atmosphere being that close in. No planet that close to a star is going to have an atmosphere or survive it for very long. But this one does. Though it almost certainly isn't the original atmosphere, because no hydrogen or helium was detected. Instead, Webb detected carbon monoxide and carbon dioxide, which is probably being replenished by volcanism. But also, being a super Earth, it has higher gravity with which to retain an atmosphere. So it shows that Type K can have planets with atmospheres. But also that a planet can regain an atmosphere after its original one was blown into space. And it's worth noting that Earth's atmosphere isn't its original one either. Ours too is a secondary atmosphere, as is that of Venus and Mars. Number 1. Terraforming Mars with glitter. The idea of terraforming Mars has been taking some hits lately. It was thought not all that long ago that Mars had enough water and carbon dioxide locked up in its subsurface that if it could all be melted, a greenhouse effect could be developed that would warm Mars up to habitable temperatures, and eventually, over a very long period of time, thousands of years, transform Mars into an analog of Earth. These hopes were dashed, however, when it was discovered several years ago that Mars simply does not have enough of these materials locked up to do it. But that didn't completely kill the dreams of terraforming Mars. Rather, it put it into a different arena, because greenhouse gases aren't the only way to warm a planet. Most of the other methods, however, are difficult because they involve transporting something from Earth to Mars. So if you want to add methane or CFCs or whatever gases to warm the place up, you need an enormous amount of them that might not be so easily produced on Mars. That was until now. A new plan originating from Edwin Kite and colleagues at the University of Chicago, Event Horizon interview coming soon, suggests that iron or aluminum rods, very, very tiny ones, micrometers, could be manufactured on Mars and released as clouds that will serve to warm up the planet and melt the water. If you did this on a large enough scale, the timeframes are nothing short of astounding. You don't need many of these clouds, you just need to let sunlight through and trap heat. As a result, this method surprisingly is on the order of 5,000 times more efficient than greenhouse gases or any other method of terraforming Mars. So how long will it take and how much metal is needed? Not that much. This method is very efficient and basically would involve something like 1% of the metal production we do here on Earth. Still a monumental undertaking of manufacturing, but a large enough Mars colony should be able to do it, and there is no shortage of iron on Mars, that's what makes it red. And it also has abundant aluminum ores, just like Earth, and we still have the SpaceX plan. So what's the time frame before Mars returns to being a liquid water world using this method? That depends on how much of the material you put into the atmosphere, but it can range from a decade down to just a few months to raise Mars globally to human comfortable temperatures. That does not speak to thickening the Martian atmosphere to Earth levels. It would be warmer, but devoid of oxygen, require management. It's unclear what happens to the rods when a rain cycle forms up again, they may rain out, and many other factors. Mars also needs a magnetic field. The plans by Jim Green actually present a very doable, and frankly rather easy way to equip Mars with an artificial magnetic field. It just requires a relatively small spacecraft. And then there's the question of whether we really want to very rapidly alter Mars like this, and what happens to any microbial life that might still be there, and so on. But this certainly is one more tool in the terraforming kit. Thanks for listening. I'm futurist and science fiction author John Michael Godier, currently still not going to Mars, no matter how fast it can be made nice. You think as much as I talk about space, I'd actually want to go there, but I actually don't. I like my comfortable armchair too much. I'll stay here on Earth with the Komodo dragons and the real butter, and be sure to check out my books at your favorite online book retailer and subscribe to my channels for regular in-depth explorations into the interesting, weird, and unknown aspects of this amazing universe in which we live.